Hi, everybody. I'm Seichen Sun. I'm a faculty member at the Industrial and Systems Engineering at USC. And today I'm very pleased to be talking to you about some of the projects that I've done on tuberculosis, or TB, in India. So TB now kills more people than HIV worldwide, which is surprising to a lot of people. And most of my work is focused on India in the context of Indian tuberculosis, because about a quarter of the world's cases reside here. And besides many of the drug-sensitive, or DS, cases in TB, one of the problems facing India is a growing number of drug-resistant tuberculosis cases, of which about 3% of all cases are. So drug-resistant TB will happen when patients undergo antibiotic therapy, but they don't finish their regimens, or it can also occur because of direct transmission. So I'll talk about both of those pathways today. And the problem that drug-resistant, or DRTB, presents is really that it requires treatment with second-line antibiotics, which can be more costly and can be more toxic to the patient, and can also be very difficult to diagnose because these patients will present with the same symptoms as a drug-sensitive TB patient. So I'm going to talk about some of the work that I've done in this area. Obviously, there's a lot of projects here, so I'm not going to talk about all of them, but I welcome questions on any of them. I won't talk about this Gates Foundation model comparison that I've done in the past. And Brian here will be talking a little bit more about the TB outreach resource allocation model towards the end of this talk. And Kerr will introduce some of the topics that we've been talking about for collaboration on predicting treatment default. But to move on to some of the overview of what I've done before, one of the models that I originally built was an individual level simulation on predicting drug-resistant TB prevalence prediction. So in this model, we followed individuals from birth until death, moving through different health states, whether latent drug-sensitive or drug-resistant TB, active disease, as well as treatment. And we wanted to make this model as detailed as possible. And since we were modeling Indian tuberculosis, we included many of the treatment options that are available in India, such as private treatment, as well as the one that's offered by the federal government, public treatment, for first line as well as second line therapy. So this is a pretty busy slide, just to guide you through it. We looked at, for instance, patients undergoing first line therapy. We looked into the literature for the RNTCP, or the public funding program that treats tuberculosis. It gives us 6 months of the treatment for each patient, and there were monthly risks of death and default that we incorporated into the simulation so that we would accurately model how patients behaved on these treatment programs, as well as things like drug-resistant testing, which patients undergo in first-line therapy at around month 4. And they could exit off of treatment either successfully treated or with active or latent tuberculosis if they default or failed from treatment. And so we wanted to be realistic and capture these patterns as much as possible. In addition, we wanted to include demographic and behavioral factors, since a lot of these things will inform how tuberculosis is transmitted. So for instance, transmission rates varied by age and reflected household compositions within the simulation. Transition rates depended on natural history and age, and competing mortality risks also dependent on age and sex. And in the simulation, we had treatment uptake and adherence and success that varies by age and sex, as well as by the time and what time it was in the simulation. So for instance, we had the model burn in so that our demographics would stabilize. So our patient population that we simulated within the model would reflect the age stratifications that we saw in India. And that was very important to get the population correct. And we also had population growth within the simulation, because we know the demographics within India are changing over time. And so these are matched to both historical and projections of Indian population growth for the United Nations Population Division. Over time, we had the federal treatment program ramp up. And so in the simulation, we had more and more patients have access to tuberculosis treatment over this period. And over that time, we can see that the simulation estimates here depicted in red are very similar to those that were given by the WHO from this period for both prevalence and incidence of tuberculosis. So we can be more confident that the simulation is performing in an accurate way. We also had second-line therapy ramp up over the appropriate period in the simulation, so which now we can do projections about the future to inform us about how the TB prevalence and epidemic are going to behave in the future. And over this period, we see secular trends such as population aging, which we would expect to see over this period. So now we have this really neat, cool simulation. What can we do with it? So one of the interesting things that we could do was to look at how people acquire drug-resistant TB. And this is a problem that you can't actually go and ask people about because people don't know where they got tuberculosis. And so for these cases of drug-resistant TB, which the government of India is very keen on reducing, we could split them apart into transmission-generated cases, which so people got coughed on and they acquired drug-resistant TB, versus those that were arising because of failed or incomplete treatment regimens. And we see that over time, the simulation will project that a larger and larger proportion of people are getting cases directly through transmission. And this has implications for how we can treat drug-resistant TB and how we can interrupt the process of people getting these diseases. The second topic I'm going to touch a little bit on is looking at policy prioritization and looking at cost-effectiveness analysis to inform policy decisions. So for instance, the government of India is planning to acquire expensive new gene expert diagnosis systems, which allows for more accurate TB diagnosis and is also very quickly able to distinguish between drug-sensitive and drug-resistant tuberculosis. Now, these are very expensive systems, so we wanted to inform the government about how they should use them. So one of the ways that we could use them is to just use them for drug-resistant testing at month number 4 in first-line therapy, but we can also introduce these systems for initial diagnosis. So we wanted to look at the costs and the health impacts of doing both of these policies, and we compared them against institutional reforms like public-private mixes or PPM programs, which the government of India is also considering doing, where private clinic patients are referred to public clinics because public clinics generally have more oversight and more informed doctors that are looking specifically for TB patients. We also looked at combination strategies of these different policies. And by informing the simulation, the individual level simulation, with information about costs as well as health outcomes, we can form the cost-effective frontier for all of the policies that we considered, being able then to identify the trade-offs between health and costs, and tell the government where there were inefficient policies that were not lying on that effective frontier. And so this sort of analysis can inform public policy in terms of healthcare. The last problem that I want to touch on is about when to test for drug-resistant tuberculosis. And this was solved using a POMDP model. So there are two tests that is used for first-line therapy. Sputum smear tests, or SS tests, are very cheap, but they're also very inaccurate. They can have very low sensitivity, so they're very noisy, and they also cannot detect the disease strain. So these types of tests, which are currently used, give us a very noisy estimate of whether a patient has TB or not. Drug sensitivity testing, or DST, which we'll consider in the context of these expensive new gene expert systems, are very expensive, as I told you before, but they're very accurate, and it can detect the disease strain. So the question we asked here was how we could use this noisy test to identify which patients need DST and when they should undergo DST. So we want to have high-risk patients and use that expensive but very accurate test on them so that we can triage them into the appropriate second-line therapy. Right now, DST, drug sensitivity testing, is being done at month 4, but with this new technology, it's unclear whether or not we should do it earlier or later in that first-line therapy treatment. And so we wanted to define patient-specific DST times that would prevent unnecessary testing, which has high financial costs, but you'd want to do it because it would accelerate triage and appropriate treatment for those patients that did have drug-resistant tuberculosis. Now, recall, only about 3% of the TB cases in India have drug-resistant TB, so it's a pretty low population. So we want to focus on these high-risk patients that we would be able to identify using this test. So just to give you an overview of our POMDP, at every month there would be some belief state that the physician had about the patient, whether or not they were successfully treated, whether they still had drug-sensitive TB or had drug-resistant TB. They were then able to do three actions, either DST that patient using that expensive test that's very accurate, or have the patient continue on treatment either with or without a noisy test from the sputum smear test. The patient would undergo treatment, and if the physician wanted to test the patient, receive a noisy positive or negative test result from the patient, and then be able to update their belief about the patient's health state. So this would continue for the 6 months of TB treatment. And we ran our POMDP in order to find the result. And we found that, in fact, it was optimal to DST the patient at initial diagnosis. This is somewhat surprising because there's very few number of TB cases that have drug-resistant TB. And so we would be unnecessarily testing a lot of people, which has high financial costs. Now, this is, in fact, driven by TB transmission because those downstream costs of further transmission, identifying those people, bringing them into treatment, and then treating them with second-line therapy was so high, it was worth it to do that unnecessary testing up front. So those are some of the topics that I've done research on, and Brian will now talk about TB outreach programs and resource allocation.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Brian Wilder, and I'll be picking up with some recent ongoing work on tuberculosis in India. So Z already covered the basic motivation here, and the focus of this work is how do we get more patients into treatment for tuberculosis in the first place, because treatment is provided for free, right? So this is one of the major bottlenecks. And a common strategy for this is outreach campaigns, right? So patients either don't know tuberculosis symptoms or they don't know that treatment is available. And so the government will conduct these advertising campaigns, right, to raise awareness and get people into treatment when they think that they might have TB symptoms. And so this is just one example of such an advertisement. And there are many others, right? And there are many ways that we can structure these campaigns. So maybe the ad on the far left here is aimed at parents of small children. The one in the middle is aimed at sports fans and so on. So there are many different demographic groups that I can think of advertising to. And I only have a limited amount of money with which to conduct these campaigns. And so the question that we're interested in this work is, given that I have this limited budget, how should I divide it up between different demographic groups in the population? So who are the sorts of people that I should focus the most resources on in order to have the greatest impact on TB rates overall? So in this work, I'll give sort of a brief overview. So we introduce an SAS-style multi-agent model of disease spread. And then in this model, we give an algorithm called DOMO to compute a near-optimal resource allocation, so a division of a finite budget between different demographic groups in the population. So we're able to both give theoretical guarantees for this approach, and then we also conduct a data-driven evaluation and simulation of the policies produced by our algorithm. And we find that by using its recommendations compared to an extrapolation of status quo policies, we can avert thousands of case years of tuberculosis each year in India. So as a brief overview, the style of model that we have here in this work is a compartmental model. So we have different demographic groups, in this case, a segmentation of the population by age. And so there's a finite population of agents inhabiting these groups. They're born, they age, they die, they move between groups, and so on. And so, and they also transmit the disease. So there are some agents that are infected, and agents in each group have some rate with which they come into contact with agents in other groups. And if you come into contact with an infected agent, then you yourself become infected. So then when we think about optimal targeting of resources in this model, there are a number of challenges. So you might say, well, why don't I just target the groups that have the most infected agents, right? That's where I'll sort of get the most bang for my buck in terms of targeting advertisements. But this doesn't work on its own because maybe some groups are more important for between group spread, right? So if there's a particular age range that's in contact with lots of others, then even if they don't have as many infected agents in terms of sheer number, maybe you should still focus advertisements there to reduce prevalence rates downstream. But that on its own also isn't sufficient, right? Because I would suggest, okay, maybe I should look at contact patterns and just immunize and just target advertisements at the groups that have the most sort of contact with others. But that also isn't optimal because you have to think about the demographics of the population and how things will evolve over time as people age and move and so on. Then complicating all of this, right? These difficulties in what the optimal strategy might be. There's just lots of things that you don't know about the problem in practice. So in particular for TB in India, we found initial prevalence rates. So the number of infected agents in each group are really uncertain because a lot of patients don't report to approved treatment facilities. And we also don't know these contact patterns between the groups, right? So I don't really know like what is the rate at which people who are 20 years old come into contact with people who are 40 years old, right? These are just things that we don't really have good data on. And so I'm not going to go into really any detail about the algorithm here, but the sort of gist of it is that we we construct an optimization problem, sort of modeling these different trade-offs. And so our approach to the DOMO algorithm has sort of a principled way of deciding on the optimal treatment in a way that accounts for the different sorts of demographic and epidemiological factors in the problem, and also accounts for the incompleteness of our data, right? So it solves a stochastic problem where we have only uncertain knowledge, so we only have sort of distributions over what many of the parameters in the problem might look at. And so we conduct an evaluation in simulation of the policies produced by DOMO. And so we use existing data from a variety of sources, right? So government reports, the RNTCP program, the epidemiological literature, and so on. And then given that there's still a lot of uncertainty in the data, then we construct appropriate sort of distributions over the parameters that we don't know about. And here as a brief snapshot of the results. So we're comparing our algorithm to, so we compared it to a range of different heuristics and strategies that you could think of for the problems, and there's a few of them here. And so these strategies are, you know, what if you just focus on the groups with the highest prevalence rates? What if you extrapolate from the status quo treatment rates, right? Just focus your resources in proportion to what's being done now. And lastly, what quote high degree. So if you focus on the groups that have the highest amount of contact with others. And we find that our algorithm can substantially improve on these existing sorts of policies and avert thousands of person years of tuberculosis each year compared to these strategies. So this is where we're at right now with, you know, a model and algorithm for targeting TB outreach campaigns. We have promising simulation results, but this is very much an ongoing project, and I hope to talk to many of you about work in this area during the breaks. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So if you have any clarification questions while the next speaker sets up, you can just ask a quick question.
At the end of your talk, you mentioned that doing the DST in the initial stage is the best. Does it mean that you have to do it for every patient, or is there any filter at all you can do to suspect that someone has drug-resistant TB?
So in the context of our model, we assumed that the only information that the physician had was national prevalence levels. So 3% of the patients would be drug-resistant, and everybody else would be drug-sensitive. And so we assumed everybody would be exposed to DST in that case, and it was still cost-effective to do it. So our objective function there was taking into account both costs and health outcomes. And if you looked for a long enough time horizon, in fact, it was cost-saving because of those save costs from not having to treat downstream infection.